Okay, I had quite a fancy description for the book this time. It was written when I was hoping to accomplish everything written there before Lisbon. It's not quite there, but we did some progress and had a show how Scratchbox started and what's it now and where we are going. Most of you here probably haven't been involved in the early Scratchbox, so perhaps a little bit of history will help to understand. Originally, Scratchbox was a built environment for an open-ended style distribution that was compiled from scratch, having a set of makefiles defining the rules of what is included. The developers figured out that there's quite a bit of stuff that you need to do yourself to make the compile. It was boring, especially when the amount of packages grew. Packages were typically taken directly from gmv.org and so on. And they often did not have the architecture patches and other stuff needed to cross-compile it. And this stuff was usually found then from debianlib.gz files. And the developers were lazy, so they decided it was easier to create a workaround than to fix everything. And this was CPU transparency. And I will explain later what it actually means. And there's a few other workarounds needed to make the applications believe that they're actually being natively compiled while they're really cross-compiled. And this was priced at Scratchbox. This eventually opened the possibility of compiling unmodified Debian packages, which is where I became involved with this. What is Scratchbox? This is one of the top 5 search terms for how people find Scratchbox.org. I think it's quite unclear to people what it actually is. This slide is stolen from Timo Savola's presentation. And he's one of the original Scratchbox developers. Or not original, quite early. And while this is technically true, it's a bit marketing speak and doesn't actually explain what it is. In practice, Scratchbox can be probably broken into these pieces. CPU transparency, which I already mentioned, and having a large pile of POS tools ready, and having the target libraries in normal locations, binary redirection, root integration, and so on. And of course, hubless, we believe that we are the best, solution. CPU transparency allows you to execute binaries of target architecture while you are cross-compiling. So when a configurer runs a test, in theory, if you write the configure and the AC correctly, it will just skip the test if you are cross-compiling. But in practice, this was not really true. Developers either did not know how to properly use automate, or they just didn't care about cross-compiling. And then there's of course things like monolithic X, which first compiles IMAKE and then uses IMAKE to compile the rest of the stuff, which kind of sucks if you try to cross-compile it. And originally it was written so that you would just SSH to the target machine, NFS mount, and run the binary from there. It worked, but it was slow and fragile. So SSH was replaced by SBRSH, which includes the whole set of connecting to the target host, NFS mounting, executing the binary, and tunneling the fake root data over. And now that QEMU has appeared, it's actually even more easier. You don't even need a target machine to cross-compile. Post tools means is important because when you're compiling a package, you often use much of the build time somewhere else than actually in the GCC, especially if you have a really slow large downloading, unpacking, running this stuff, it takes really long. Those tools are located under Scratchbox Tools and Scratchbox Dev Kits. And they are compiled specifically for Scratchbox with a prefix and some patches and hacks to make applications work correctly from a location that is not regular. The positive side is that it means that Scratchbox comes with everything you will actually need to develop. Dark side is that it makes Scratchbox huge and tedious to maintain. Tablet libraries are located in their usual locations instead of some deeply located place, which is more typical for the other cross-compiling solutions. This means that we don't need to mangle the packages we install. You can just apt-get any target library or package you want. Now, if multi-arc existed and worked, we could just forget this part. But this has been... we've been waiting for this quite a long and it hasn't appeared. And even if it appears, it doesn't help for the non-Debian-based distributions until they follow the multi-arc control program in a few years. And the best side of having everything that is target-related in your root means that you can use the root directory as an NFS root base or just wrap it into a tarball and root into that root. Yeah, of course.
I'm kind of drunk now. Is this all in CH root or?
Yes.
So, so it contains basically all of the target system with all the built tools.
Yeah. Binary redirection is needed because we just move everything to under Scratchbox, which means that if you have something like hashband rules, they are being made like in Debian rules file, it won't run because either rules are being made doesn't exist because you haven't bothered to compile it, or it's an ARM binary or whatever target architecture you have with and slow. So you want to redirect it to the correct path post tool. And for this reason there's an LD preloaded hack to redirect in the several paths. This has the problem that if you're trying to build parallel Python modules, it usually redirects you to the wrong parallel version. And there are some ways to work around it, but it's not as easy to build as normal C libraries or stuff like that. And this isn't actually part of Scratchbox, but related. We have created a tool named Crocodile, cross-compiling whatever. It's a script that builds everything you give to it and that attempts to build them in an iterative way of first building the things that don't depend on anything and then the things that depend on them and so on. It allows you to compile a set of packages completely out of scratch, so you don't have any of the target libraries available when you start. The core libraries are brought from the tool chain instead of compiling them, because GFC and GCC build processes are quite complex, and you already have the libraries in the cross-compiling tool chain anyway. The build dependency loops are broken because we already have the tools available as host tools. We can't break them for libraries, but for any kind of tools that is called by exec, we can just forget them. Yeah.
So the bits are taken from the tool chain. So if you're building a brand new architecture, then you haven't necessarily got your parts yet. Can you just build on the UI of this?
Yeah.
To stop you just saying that you've got the fact that it might not work. When is you should be able to do a whole brand new architecture, you're not dependent on there already being a Scratchbox version of toolchain.
No, you need to build the toolchain first to be able to compile for that.
Yeah, build that in a Scratchbox way.
You already can use any tool chain nowadays.
Okay.
So this has been tested to me on some exotic combinations. And this is the tool we use to test that Scratchbox user works these days. And of course, like, since all the host tools are still in the Sarge level, we currently probably can't build anything but Sarge out of this. Some alternatives which probably are worth reviewing because, well, people have probably tried already something else. Native compiling, well, it's the nice part that you don't have to worry about cross-compiling problems at all, it just works, but it's really slow. And in cases of some really slow architectures, it might be that no one has actually ever used that native toolchain. For example, I think one of the recent examples of this was the Water trying to bootstrap the coal fire architecture. No one had probably run that minutes because it didn't work. Then the exact opposite end is to fix the build systems and just build them with correct flags and like open embedded does. This is of course the proper way. Instead of working around things, you fix them. And it's not as big a problem as it used to be when Scratchbox was originally developed, because open embedded has come a really long way. And many other people have also fixed their packages. Also, things like iMake have died their horrible death finally. Why we are currently using them is because managing the libraries and target tools becomes quite a big problem with hundreds of packages. It becomes really tedious and there isn't really proper tools to manage them, like MPG. There is MPG Cross, which is kind of helps, but it doesn't get all the build emphasis, if I remember correctly. It might not be easy, for example, GTK2 wants to create some things based on the IO modules that have been compiled. And for every iMake that dies, there's some new system that is created, and the new system developer doesn't always like remember that there are some things like cross-compiler that should be supported. Open embedded is of course the best example.
Now one question, you said new build systems appear, but at least some of them are already designed to support cross-compilation. For example, I use in my company Sconce for cross-compilation and works easily, so.
Well, Sconce was just an example of a new system. It's
okay.
I'm not aware of it having any problems.
Yeah. But I think with the new systems, people are more open to those problems than at the times when iMake was invented, hopefully.
Also extend a bit on, you said earlier that you can fix the configurators with us.
Yeah.
But actually, if you just fix it by not running the library, then how do you get the result of the configurator decision?
Exactly.
I mean, dpkg cross basically provides a set of standard answers to fill in where things don't work. Obviously, has its limitations. If you're actually trying to discover something that changes dynamically, then you know it's got to get the answer from somewhere. So Open Embedded actually has complicated schemes of arbitrary scripts that can be run at any process to go and find things out somehow. But yeah, that is a fundamental problem with the way it works.
Out of
just missing out the tests doesn't solve your problem, really.
as a way of storing their answers somewhere into a cache file. Sure, what it was actually called. Okay, one of the compromises is to run the actual package build on a native host, but instead of executing the GCC there, it's executed via GCC on a cross-compiler on a faster machine. It is really easy to set up, and it probably compiles everything that you will compile natively as well. On the other hand, like I mentioned earlier, it's not always the GCC that takes all the time. And this doesn't help you solve and build dependency loops if you're trying to bootstrap something, because you need all the host tools available on the target system. And however, this has been used, for example, with the big Endian ARM project, because they have the really simple NSLU2 hardware available, but they want to compile faster. Another one I saw was on this presentation available on the Self Wiki, where they were fighting configurator problems and decided to go this way. Okay, now it's finally into the Scratchbox 2.0. Scratchbox 2.0's basic idea is to extend the exec redirection to open redirection. So when we decided that we can redirect the binary calls, we might as well redirect the open calls of the, when the binaries are trying to access some of their data files. This would allow us to manage the host tools with apt-get instead of having this massive set of packages compiled as part of Scratchbox. And the need here is that if we do this, Scratchbox is really only the code that is part of Scratchbox and is thus small enough to be included in Debian and could probably be used in official Debian package compiling. Unfortunately, it's not as ready as I hoped at this point it would be. Like mentioned earlier, we can't compile edge concurrent Scratchbox because the tools are based on Sarge and updating them is a bit of tedious and repeating work, which would have been to be done every time a package is updated in Debian. We would have to update the Scratchbox host tools. A bit like the IA32libs package that is currently used on to provide IA36 support on AMD64, except that it's exponentially larger. And so we're just thinking that why can't the APT get installed on those tools? To make that possible, we will need to be able to run unmodified their binaries from Scratchbox instead of the ones which have RPath set and prefix set when compiling them. The first part is to actually execute the binaries from Scratchbox. Each of the binaries currently in Debian, they have their dynamic binary starts with libldsr.linux, which is the interpreter. We can't use that because that one is actually for the target architecture currently. So instead, in exec, we call ldso and with the proper library path. This was done for Scratchbox 1.03 and it works relatively well. This is the part that allows you to use toolchains that are not compiled for Scratchbox. The second part is to allow these binaries to read all the data files and plugins and stuff which are actually not under Scratchbox, are under Scratchbox. For this, we need the redirection of file calls. At Extremadura, we started this work in a more serious attempt than just like having it as an idea that we should do someday. And the first implementation was based on fake CX root, which already has all functions content to run language access file system. So instead of just having a static place where to redirect, you can just set it up a configured file which allows you to select what to redirect and where. This part is done at least in a prototype level. So instead of fixing this to make it work properly, we did a second implementation, this time based on views, to say that file system in user space, which allows you to implement file systems in user space, and is part of Linux since 2.6.8. So this was also done very quickly, and it also works now. Now, since we are quite unsure what kind of configuration format we want and where we actually need redirecting, we are using Lua scripts to figure out, to hack like where we want to redirect and what. We put the Lua scripts under Scratchbox reader scripts and just hope that we will be able to, now that we have the framework, we can start hacking with just the Lua without touching the C code anymore. And we are now left with the hard questions of actually making it work and having a proper rule set available. Currently, the wrapper or the Fuse engine calls a function called Sbox Translate Path, which is the Lua entry point. And it is really simple. It gets the binary name, the function name is either the glibc function that handles the file, or in the case of the Fuse engine, it's the one of the BFS level functions calling the file system. And in a more real situation, we will not call in this place a very binary, but we will instead parse the file and actually see. Lua has that nice property of being really lightweight and fast to start, so it doesn't add much overhead even in the LE preload case. To choose whether we want to use Fuse or LE preload, there are some pluses and minuses, and we are not quite sure which one we will continue working on. Fuse is really fast because the Lua engine is started only once when the Fuse engine is started. It's really robust, you can tamper it from the process space like you can do for the LE preload. It requires a relatively new kernel, and 2.4 is still unfortunately quite popular. It knows less of the context of the binary because you can't look into the memory of the application being run, and you don't have the level of glibc functions. VFS has less, it's a lower level. Okay.
Because of this only building machine.
Yeah.
So probably not too much of a restriction to require 2.6.8 level on build basis, is it? Is it moving forward?
LD preloads. Well, we are more familiar with working with it. It works with any kernel as long as it uses ELF. And it gets the complete context of the process it's being executed in. But probably it's not a good idea to poke into the memory of the application to figure out when to redirect, but in case it's needed, it could be possible. LD preload that might be needed anyway. For example, we want to wrap the uname syscall in case some of the configure scripts uses that to figure out what architecture we're building for. It's slower since the Lua engine is started where every process started. You could work it around with some kind of daemon, but more hasn't been done so far. Then we have the option of starting from completely scratch and forgetting the current infrastructure of scratch blocks, and, like completely new scripts and start a revolution, basically. There are some scripts like this already in the scratch box to Dart's repository, but they don't set up the system completely ready yet. The positive side is that we could upload it to Debian right now. It doesn't work much, but it could be there and we could get started quickly. But to reach the level of current scratch box, so all of the same tools that are available in this version of scratch box 1.25, which is the latest, it will take quite a while to make compiles and fuse simple packages, which will be done in a month or so. The evolutionary path would mean that we would just add open redirection as a new feature for the current scratch box. So we would basically get install more tools or update the tools that are there, write the rules for whenever you need something new there. This could make working much faster. It wouldn't break the habits of the current scratch box users. But on the other hand, it will be take quite a while until people would actually bother to start removing their old versions of packages that are compiled as part of scratch box. So it will replacing the tools like made one by one by first apt get installing it, making it work, and then removing the old compiled made would take some while. Usually evolutionary approach is better than revolution, since things don't work for a very long time. So it doesn't make people happy. Any extra questions?
So really, how many packages in Debian are really broken in the first compilation? I mean, not trivially broken, but like that would require some serious patching. Do you have an estimate on that?
Not really. Probably someone who has actually used it there.
Actually, I talked to the student people.
Yeah.
Here, unfortunately, they're the people who spent most time recently trying to properly cross-build. I mean, there's 1,300 packages in Open Embedded, and last time I looked, which was a while ago, most of those had custom-compiled patches.
13,000?
Sorry?
1,300.
1,300.
Yeah.
So, I think a lot of packages have trivial problems. There are probably aren't that many that have serious problems. I understand that actually open bit come across a bit. So there's a few that are kind of fundamentally weird. And open office is actually very hard.
Well, open office is in the volume and other things.
But, yeah, we don't know. I think that's really the answer.
An older version of OpenOffice actually in Debian, it had a logo which was in GIMP source format, and during the build process it started GIMP into a virtual X and used that to make a PNG out of this file. And
that's OpenOffice.
That was Debian OpenOffice.
Oh. Yes, because there are like at least three going before it's working on producing patches for post-compilation.
Yeah,
so it should not be like that hard to join that fight and do the rights in the trademark.
I think that needs to happen eventually, it's going to fix everything. And OpenBed has done an awful lot of that work, but somebody's got to take all those patches and either at least get them into the Debian patch and preferably get them into upstream, which is a very boring task. We'd all like to see that happen independently.
But this does still not solve the problem of managing the target libraries which are installed in the non-standard location.
I think new applications are created all the time unless everybody has an incentive to make cross-compiling work, and there will always be new work.
No, actually the new autoproofs are like covering better and better.
Some of these fixes actually all the way up to auto tools and actually fix the problem for everybody.
So it's actually
so
the
so what's the last release auto tools update to actually get the new route into the thing. Some of it's actually quite generic and will fill the debt, but that's it's a long process. And people don't update their auto tools until it breaks.
But it's not just about like developer ignorance.
Also, do you have like an estimate on speed of computing like natively on the host priming Sprite box for that host, some program, and computing inside Sprite box? Because I would assume because of that preload, afterwards the fuse one, you would have to run like a couple dozen configure tests and whatever, it should take some time to...
There was some measurement done on older version of Sprite box with TTK2 compilation of most native and the Sprite box compilation, and it was something like they were able to compile in Sprite box TTK2 something like 20 times by the time the ARM, it was a 400 MHz ARM box with the ARM.
No, but not with respect to an ARM native ARM board, but on the machine native built on the machine Sprite box this is running. So just to see how
native,
much
native
how much Sprite box really slows down compilation on that computer.
I'm not sure. Much of this overhead is not that big if you use fake boot on that native host as well. Like maybe a package preview usually uses. And how much overhead does Fakeroot usually have over Sumo?
I don't know that anyone's done any benchmarks.
Do you know the thing? Slow down things that you need to kill you to execute. It's not relatively slow, but there isn't very much. That doesn't happen most of the time, there isn't. I'm not sure how much of the time is given to that. So, I think the bottom line is it's not much slower.
If you use SBRSH, which sends the binary to the target host and runs it there, that slows it down quite a bit, but QFO is really fast. Depends on how many libraries you have.
But you just cross-install them as soon as you have to get installed. I mean, the problem is that you can't do, at the moment, there isn't a single command apt-get cross-install library now.
Which would pull all that dependent libraries.
Which would just get only need to put them in. But that's not, isn't it? It's not at all difficult. Needs to, at the moment, on our phone, it's incredibly annoying because you have to do it manually for each library.
Yeah.
It's really tedious. But I can't see that it's actually difficult to just add a bit of deep-packaged cross knowledge to apt, I suppose, to deal with dependencies.
And much of this, what Sprite box deals with, is not really useful. We have a really tiny embedded system. Something like tens of packages maximum. But if you have something bigger, then it's the overhead of fixing everything and working on everything gets quite big.
The other thing it does, didn't really get mentioned, cross building allows to solve the problem of running install scripts without having actual target device to run them on.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if any other solution to it. Well, the only other solution is to net mount your image, an NFS mount your image on the target, and then run the install script there. So even if you don't use Sprite box for the cross building bar, it's still really useful at the install stage.
Measuring actually how long it would take. takes some time to configure it.
Also, there are like several packages, like simple example would be GCC, but for me it builds, compiles itself three times.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm sure you can like catch the few hours compilation which uses PostGCC, and the other two which use XGCC will have to be emulated by QEM.
Yeah, that would be quite slow.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, if you're cross-compiling anyway, you don't really have the need to cross-compile GCC to create a native compiler.
Yeah, but that's like, you're just going on board for that. You do like in one stage cross GCC,
yeah,
and in another stage native GCC with that cross GCC.
And you could probably do that.
So how do you handle like that case? There are like the GCC case, there are like several build system for like Perl that first builds mini Perl and then uses that mini Perl to create a lot of C files, header files, whatever. And then
in this specific example Perl, you can do so that you will have a host compiled mini Perl, and then when the build process starts, tries to run the cross-compiled mini Perl, you will redirect that one to the host compiled. We have done that and makes it quite a bit faster.
Yeah. Are you handling these cases with like Perl, Python, stuff like that, or it's just like a feature point?
It's been done for Perl, but you have to do it by hand. Mini Perl is not included like in the Python. You need to compile it for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You could probably do the same for Python, but I have no experience on that.
So, you don't just have this in Scratchbox, this mini build thing.
Well, it's kind of version dependent of what version of Perl you want to compile.
Right.
With what options and so on.
But doesn't there mean allow us to have lots of versions of Perl installed at once?
I mean, but if you put the mini Perl into Scratchbox, then you can only compile that version of Perl in with that tool. And it's updating the mini Perl in Scratchbox would be 10 years, and it quite makes sense.
This looks all like code chain independent, so I'm very useful, so probably we are using the Perl.
In Scratchbox in general, or this mini Perl?
No, it's friendly, in general.
Yeah, you can use it with UCLibC. For example, we have done this port to CRISP architecture,
mm-hmm,
and a CRISP UCLibC Debian-based compilation, and it worked. Of course, it was quite big, and this specific port had 2 megabytes of flash, so it was just NFS booted.
Yeah. Thank you.